This is the Ford F-150, the best-selling car in the United States for the past 30 years. This 2-ton pickup is the epitome of the American spirit. Every year, Ford sells 900,000 of these cars. But suddenly, in February, the Kansas production site switched from 3 work shifts down to 2, while the Detroit factory kept only 1 shift running. If you have ever worked at a factory, you know that the cancellation of entire shifts can occur only in critical cases. Every minute spent at the assembly line is worth its weight in gold, and the management tries to squeeze out every second of labor to increase productivity. And then imagine a car giant cuts off 16 hours of hundreds of people's work. It is March. The problems are increasing, affecting 6 more factories in other states. But now it doesn't stop at the cancellation of shifts, the entire production is stopped. The action of this magnitude is taken when there is a hurricane or earthquake kind of disaster. In April, another wave of downtime hits the factory in Turkey. In May, that is almost now, the situation is pretty much the same. Ford releases the updated data on the underproduction of its cars. The figure rises from 200,000 to 1 million, and the lost revenue is projected to be $2.5 billion. So, what was the cause of this collapse? It happened because there weren't enough components. Or rather because of this little bastard, which detects the presence of voltage. Right now, in 2021, the perfect storm of the new crisis is raging. After watching this video till the end, you'll learn what monopolists, gamers, factories, and 5G towers have in common. Crisis. It's any event that may lead to an unstable and dangerous situation affecting an individual, group, or all of society.
Oi!
When people talk about the microchip crisis, they use the word shortage, implying that there is a scarcity of chips in the world, and because of that, ordinary gamers cannot buy graphics cards. But in reality, it's the opposite.
What are you talking about, Boney? Check out the stores! There are either no cards on the shelves or they cost 3 times as much!
Yes, exactly. But this is not due to a lack of supply, but due to explosive demand. Since the number of graphics cards sold hasn't dropped one bit, it's quite the opposite. Look, here are the statistics of Nvidia cards shipments. Just before the pandemic, when prices were very reasonable, Nvidia sold 8 million units. Yes, there was a slight drawdown at the beginning of the lockdown, but then the figures very quickly returned to normal, and shipments have been growing to this day. Now, if you take a broader look at the supply of all graphics processors which are found in graphics cards, laptops, and servers, you'll get the following picture. Until the end of 2019, sales of electronics were going up. But then the pandemic hit, and the big analysts of the market entered the stage. By the way, their detailed reports can cost up to $30,000. Yep, as much as a brand new SUV. Sorry, we just wanted to buy their report ourselves, but then saw the price. So, at the beginning of 2020, those analysts said,
"This is the third consecutive quarter of increased GPU shipments. However, Q1, which is seasonally flat to down, may show an unusual dip because of supply chain interruptions from China due to the coronavirus epidemic."
But all of a sudden, it turns out that the drop wasn't so dramatic, and by the third quarter, sales not only recovered but exceeded pre-pandemic levels. The real explosion of electronics purchases took place in late 2020, reaching all-time highs when 120 million GPUs found in laptops, computers, and servers were sold. That is, in all your fancy devices. So, my dear friend, if you're looking for a graphics card or a PlayStation 5, I will tell you that it's all out there. There is just no time to snatch one because alongside you, 10 other lads are fighting for it, ready to pay hundreds of dollars for a brand new toy. But why did this happen? The answer to this question is very extensive. The shortest one is pandemic, or rather lockdown, or rather the new need of people sitting at home to enhance their apartments with new devices, so that a dad could work remotely, a mum could do her stretching and a child could do their homework. By the way, remember this graph showing that 119 million devices with GPUs were sold at the beginning of the year. Out of those, there were 90 million laptops. By the way, this is the largest number of laptops sold in history. As those cool analysts say, the demand for Chromebooks has had a big impact. By the way, when I was making this video, I learned that the whole modern world uses these computers in schools instead of pens and notebooks. It turned out that all over the world, people are connected to learning tools through 40 million Chromebooks, most of them in the US, Europe, and Australia. And while mum is doing stretches with her online coach and dad attends a Zoom meeting in the next room, they don't even realize how much they overload the data centers. The pandemic has caused such rapid growth in the number of users that it is difficult to comprehend. Check this out. At the end of 2019, when we didn't know what COVID was, there were 10 million users a day. Fast forward to March 2020, when lockdowns had become a common thing. How many Zoom users do you think were making calls? 20 million? 50? 80? There were 200 million users in March, and in less than a month, it rose to 300 million. 300 million users generate tons of videos per day. Another service, Microsoft Teams, shows a similar dynamic. In 2019, there were 20 million users, and after the lockdown, the figures skyrocketed to 75, 115, and 145 million. And as you can see, the growth continues. And you might ask, what is the connection between the expansion of the server's capacity and your inability to beef up your computer? Here is the explanation. Servers use AMD EPYC microprocessors, which are built on the same Zen 2 chipsets as the Ryzen processors you use to play games, as well as this Threadripper processor costing half a used car. It is intended not for gaming, but for rendering top-end animation, even the Terminator. To be honest, even I didn't understand what I just said, but something tells me that the reason for all that is a dramatic imbalance in a very important market. Let's try to summarize the components of an ideal storm that we are just beginning to realize. Being stuck within four walls created a need for new computers. These new computers provoked the purchase of servers, thereby increasing the demand for chips for users and companies at the same time. However, the production of chips is falling behind, because all the chips in the world are made by a couple of monopolists. Pow! When we were making this video, we didn't even think that monopolies would pop up in this field. Invisible for ordinary people, they manufacture brains for all electronic devices. Every common user knows about companies like Apple, HP, Dell, LG, Lenovo, but these brands don't make the hearts of electronics themselves. They design the parts and then buy them from one giant manufacturer that is located. To all those who watched our video about the container shortage, let's say it together. That is located in Asia. To be more precise, in Taiwan. Taiwan Semiconductor Manufacturing Company makes all of it. But it's also not so simple. Other companies like Qualcomm, Nvidia, AMD first buy their chips from TSMC and then put them in your laptops, mobile phones, servers, and computers. Here's another piece of the puzzle showing how the demand for server chips can affect the availability of chips for games and movie production. AMD, being a developer, came up with its Zen 2 architecture and handed over its blueprints to the Taiwanese manufacturer that simply makes the chips. Well, it's not so simple. Semiconductor production is a costly and complex endeavor, if not the most complex one in the world. And now it becomes clear that if consumers of Nvidia, AMD, HP and others create a sharp increase in demand for chips, for example because they work from home, play games or because Ethereum price suddenly went up, then it will also affect other products that rely on chips. The demand grows rapidly, and the supply, which is created by a single manufacturer, can't keep up with it. And this gives you the answer to the question we posed in the beginning. Why the automobile factories suddenly stopped their assembly lines? Look at the Japanese company called Renesas Electronics on this chart. This company provides approximately two-thirds of all chips in the automotive industry. As you can see, the entire market was divided long ago. So, in 2018, Renesas transferred the production of chips to another company, TSMC, which we've already talked about, and focused on software and development. All for the sake of saving money, of course. The semiconductor industry works in such a way that, in order to keep a strong position in the market, you must be running assembly lines 24/7 and shipping a huge amount of silicon wafers. Therefore, literally half of the entire market is held by one Taiwanese company, and it will be difficult for a new player to enter the competition, especially without government support, but more on that later. So, the company that makes components for video cards also makes parts for automotive electronics. And then, the pandemic hits. During the first months, the car industry market dropped dramatically by some wild 50 to 80%. The workers were sent home. The factories slowed down and they lowered their predicted plans for the purchase of electronics. But somewhere in the second half of 2020, when the demand for cars quickly went back to normal, the factories began to wake up. At that point, car manufacturers called Renesas and said, "Bring me the chips." Renesas called TSMC and said, "Bring me the chips." To which TSMC replied, "Sorry, we're currently making chips for laptops and graphics cards." The end. On the one hand, the Taiwanese manufacturer is somewhat trying to meet the emerging demand for home electronics and servers. And on the other hand, the auto industry gets in the way and raises the number of orders. In case someone's wondering how many electronics there are in a car, well, car sensors are responsible for this many functions. And we're not talking about some super modern machine vision or unmanned control. This is just basic things like airbag control, seatbelt sensor, or electric power steering. All these seemingly ordinary functions have long been out there thanks to the chips. The share of electronics in all car production was 18% back in 2000, and now it's 40%. That is, about half of the cost of a car goes to all sorts of displays, wires, and sensors. And if suddenly some chip is missing, then a car cannot go on sale.
If you look at the F-150, it's a really expensive truck being probably held up by a $50, $60 part, or even less. In some cases, we had clients that had very expensive products. Say it was $1,200, being held up by a 3-cent part. The issue is you need all of them. If I don't have a 50-cent microcontroller that controls the seatbelt, I don't build the car.
All this mess revealed another problem. The same chips are used in different fields. A car doesn't need an advanced 7 nanometers process chip. Cars use bigger and older 28 nanometers processors, similar to the ones that are used to start up servers and PCs. However, with the emergence of new technologies, these new chips will be required to deploy 5G networks. Right now, you can see who the automotive industry will fight for electronics. In general, the seemingly unrelated fields compete for limited resources, the demand for which has sharply increased due to the lockdown and technological progress. Chips are required everywhere. Well, let's just make more. We double our efforts and just
do it!
Well, on paper, that plan seems reliable, like a
Swiss fucking watch.
But in reality, the workload of semiconductor production 20 years ago was at 75%, and nowadays it is close to 90%. We can say that this field is running at full throttle, and there is very little time left for changeover and equipment maintenance. And don't you think that manufacturers have been sitting around for 20 years, doing nothing? They haven't. Since 2020, their performance has been growing in absolute terms by 4% every year. As a result, over the last 20 years, the area of conductors produced has grown from 300 million square inches to 900 million square inches per month. A little more than half a square kilometer of silicon wafers are produced every month. It's a decent field of chips. The second reason is that the equipment is incredibly complex and expensive. It all happens in a so-called clean room, in which the blue spectrum is excluded from every light source. They call it a room, perhaps as a joke, because in reality it is a workshop the size of two soccer fields. The production facility has 800 pieces of automated equipment, which produce these silicon wafers, each with 1,000 chips. And one lithography machine can cost between $25 and $100 million. Having realized the seriousness of the issue, TSMC listened to your posts on the internet and decided to open a new plant in Arizona. It will require no less than $12 billion. And here is the comparison. The new facility will be able to produce 20,000 silicon wafers per month, while the main facility produces 1 million wafers. That is, the new $12 billion facility will increase production by only 2%. Chip manufacturing is now perceived as a national security issue. The White House says just that: protect US national security interests. And it plans to inject $52 billion into this field, but you remember right, for the semiconductors industry, this is not that much money. The members of the European Union claim that they would also like to make chips at home. China, which has been in a constant state of trade war with the US, is investing $1.4 billion in the tech sector to reduce its dependence on American electronics. It is clear that some of that money will go to chips. A real semiconductor race is underway, because a state's success in the world market today is based on its economy, and it is becoming more and more automated, and, if you like, microchipped. Even if we talk about weapons, some of them are also reliant on chips. Maybe not a lot, let's say about 1%, but still. I'm not an expert, but it seems to me that the Israeli Iron Dome isn't manually controlled. By the way, remember the image of a dark future where machines create machines and rule the world? Remember the AMD EPYC server chip that TSMC makes? Well, in today's reality, it works like this. The manufacturer of AMD EPYC chips uses those chips to make new chips. We already live in a quite complex tech future. In this video, we wanted to show you how interconnected our world is. However, we need to emphasize that not only Ford has suffered, but all car manufacturers in general. Increased demand for home electronics was also caused by the arrival of the new hardware generation with the new consoles, all sorts of games like Cyberpunk and other things which require new graphics cards. And on top of that, Ethereum price went up, and the miners recreated the events of 2017. There were some other disasters like fires at the Renaissance or drought in Taiwan, and there is a lot more to add. Each individual event only amplifies the impact of the chip crisis. It has been a perfect storm, and no one knows when it will end or whether it will end at all. We, people, create crises for ourselves to reach a new level, to move forward. Perhaps this is what life is all about. We hope you've learned something new. Leave a like, hit that subscribe button, and share this video with your friends. And I'm Boney Wright.